help our viewers understand how your technology is actually making this part of AI computing that much more efficient.
Thanks so much for having me. Yeah, Celestial AI is the creators of the Photonic Fabric, as you'd mentioned, which is the optical interconnectivity technology platform for accelerated computing. So said another way, we're interconnecting AI processors with light. What's happening in AI right now is that artificial intelligence workloads are growing exponentially. They're now so large, trillions of parameters, that they need to be partitioned over hundreds of processors, which puts more and more demand on the network as the processor doing the work needs to move across the network to fetch information from another processor's memory, moving it back to where the work gets done. And there's no more efficient way to move information than photonically.
Dave, you managed to snag $250 million from some institutional investors by the likes of Fidelity, Tiger, BlackRock, Maverick Capital. How do you plan to put this money to use?
Yeah, we're focused right now on scaling. So we have multiple deep collaborative development engagements with the largest hyperscale data center companies on Earth. Right now, we're collaborating with them to integrate our Photonic Fabric technology into their next generation AI accelerators. These are programs that are on the order of 18 months, so through the balance of 2025 and into the first half of next year. We're working together to get this technology scaled and qualified. So right now the focus is on our volume manufacturing supply chain because our customers are immense scale. They require hundreds of thousands of units to serve their demand.
You know, Dave, back to the fundraising question as well. Not only do you have kind of like the blue chip of finance involved in this round, Fidelity, BlackRock, but the Mavericks and Tiger part of this, it's interesting. When you have those traditional hedge funds getting in, they have been cautious in the world of startups, especially with a dearth of public market exits. So bring us behind the conversation. What is it about you and them that served as a good match?
Yeah, so we took a hard look at the types of investors that we wanted to have involved at this stage in the company's life cycle. So just as you develop a technology for successful qualification and implementation in a large market like artificial intelligence, we are developing and optimizing our cap table for having the right investors involved, not just at this phase in the company's life cycle, but through an IPO, should we make the decision to take the company public over the course of the next few years and to have the right investors that can invest with us over the course of the next decade or more. So on their end, the decision, I think, was made based on the fact that we are the only company in existence that has the ability to provide optical interconnectivity that meets the requirements of what are called scale-up networks. This is a processor-to-processor interconnect. The gold standard today is NVIDIA with NVLink and NVSwitch. All of that is run over copper. So data communication today between processors at NVIDIA and elsewhere throughout the industry today is entirely electronically over copper. With the Photonic Fabric, we are changing that, right? We're moving information optically at a fraction of the energy and at much higher bandwidths and lower latency.
You know, an interesting part of your cap table also that I've noticed, and this was an existing investor, is Porsche. And with all that's going on in the world, worries about the consumer, worries about international trade, auto parts also facing risk of tariffs, I'm wondering what role you play in the automobile story. Have they led to meaningful work with you as an investor?
So there's two different branches of Porsche. There's Porsche AG, which is the automotive group, which we all know and love. That's my favorite brand, by the way. And there's Porsche SE, which is the mothership that's the holding company for all of the Porsche's family money, as well as they control about 50% of the assets of the Volkswagen group. So this is the financial arm of Porsche. Now, Porsche can, and certainly we anticipate will be, a strategic partner for us as well on the automotive group side, as their requirements for artificial intelligence training and inference will be similar to that of Tesla, who has played kind of a leading role early on in building out AI infrastructure in support of autonomous vehicles.
Dave, how do you think about kind of diversifying your customer base? You noted that your target clientele, you know, that those effectively control more than 90% of the trillion-dollar end market. Do you get to expand past that as the company grows, or are you more dependent on those select few?
Well, like you just said, those select few represent, you know, there's eight companies that represent roughly 90% of this trillion-dollar market, and we'd be fine with just those, right? So if you think about it, that's a good problem for us to have, right? You've got four major hyperscalers. I think the world knows who they are, that represent roughly 70% of the addressable end market. And then you have the ecosystem around them, right? The GPU manufacturers, which include NVIDIA and AMD, AMD, by the way, being one of our strategic investors as well. And then there are a couple of design services companies, which include Broadcom, right? So Broadcom is playing a larger role. I think you heard from their earnings announcement over the last week and a half that they're gaining traction in building custom silicon for the hyperscalers.